Welcome to the Dead Pixel Society podcast, the photo imaging industry's leading news source. Here's your host, Gary Pageau.
The Dead Pixel Society podcast is brought to you by Media Clip, Photo Finale, and Advertech Printing. Hello again and welcome to the Dead Pixel Society podcast. I'm your host, Gary Pageau, and today we're joined by longtime photo industry executive, Glen Clark. Hello, Glen. How are you today?
Gary, I'm doing great today. Thank you for having me on. I appreciate it.
So you and I have run across each other, like we were saying before the call, in for literally decades, running into each other with the various companies you've been associated with. You've really been in the industry since the 70s, correct?
Yeah, that's correct. I graduated from De Anza College with a degree in photography in 1972. So you can do the math.
And then from there, you've worked for a variety of companies in the industry, Burrell, Marathon Press, Tap, and then you've kind of concluded your career at Bay Photo. And you've always been on the professional photography output side. What drew you to that?
Well, a love of photography, but it goes back to a story, and I'll keep it short. I graduated from college, and my draft number was number two. And I thought if I was going to go into a combat situation, I'd rather have a camera than a rifle. I don't know how smart that thinking was, but I went to De Anza College to get a degree in photography so I'd have a skill. And it just started there. I photographed weddings to get myself through college, and one thing just led to another, and it's been a path I've been on ever since.
So, yeah, you've always kind of been in the wedding portrait space. Is that something you just naturally kind were drawn to because you're a social person, or because it doesn't sound to me like you spend much time in the photojournalism space or even commercial photography or some of the other areas that were hot at that time?
Well, if I can correct you a little bit, Gary, I spent a number of years in Hollywood working for Easterbrook Photography, a commercial photography studio, and we did food, we did product, we did celebrities. So I have done both. Mm-hmm. I migrated originally to portrait and wedding primarily because, like I said, I did weddings putting myself through college, and then I got a job at the old Keith Cole Color Lab in Redwood City, California, which at the time was a national color lab all across the country, and their core business customers were portrait and wedding photographers. So that's what I grew up knowing.
Right. Now, did you ever get drafted?
I did not. And that's a terribly long story in itself. But I was having a conversation with the draft board scheduled for the day after the draft ended. So it just sort of came to a conclusion. It kind of petered out.
Okay. So it kind of wound down as you became eligible for the draft. Okay.
Exactly right.
So you've seen a lot of obviously technological change in the wedding industry. Now, what was it like in the 70s to shoot a wedding?
Well, my experience was that was the boom of 35 millimeter flash on camera. I worked for a real off brand studio that we did, $99 weddings, and we did like 20 or 30 of them in a weekend. It was scripted, and you had a shot list. And the biggest thing in the 70s and even in the 80s was it was drilled into us that every time we pushed the shutter button, it cost a dollar. Between the film and the proofing, you were spending money every time you pushed the button. Mm-hmm. So the biggest difference between then and now is back then you had to be very selective. And I worked for photographers that would literally count your rolls of film and literally keep you to a limit on how many shots to do during an event. So you were much more selective in your posing, your lighting, and your grabbing, because you wouldn't take multiple images, and you wouldn't just shoot off the cuff. You'd have to plan things. And the other major factor was, we shot knowing where the images would end up in an album. We shot left-facing pages and right-facing pages. We had in our head a script that told us we need the bride with mom and dad. We need the groom with mom and dad. We need the entire wedding party. So there was this whole kind of scenario that you dance through at an event, keeping the people in mind, but also keeping the final product in mind, if that makes sense.
Sure. Plus, you had to make sure your exposure was right on, right? Because you really had to know what you were doing in terms of exposure, because you couldn't see what you were doing. I mean, you couldn't see the end product.
That is absolutely correct. On the other hand, thanks to professional labs back then, there was some leeway, because they could fudge in the printing. But it was interesting back then, Gary. I mean, I don't know about everybody, but it was pretty common, and I did it. I had numbers handwritten on the back of my flasher that said, if I'm so many feet away, use this f-stop and use this power setting. And back then, our on-camera strobes had two settings, full power or half power, and that was it. And you didn't vary the ISO. The ISO was based on your film. If you put, 100 speed film in, that's what you had. So there wasn't as many variables as there is with the technology today.
And even then, as film technology advanced, you had various ISOs, various capabilities within the film. You had various emulsions that would convey this sort of effect, like Riala from Fuji or things like that. So I always thought that was kind of interesting when the film technology also advanced to the point where you could select different looks and feels just based on the emulsion.
Yes, and I think that was a big factor in why 2.25 formats, larger format film took off, because you had removable backs for the camera. So if you were shooting Hasselblad or shooting Mamiya, you could have a variety of emulsions of film loaded into backs, and you could switch your back. So you could go from 100 ASA to a 400 ASA to possibly an 800 ASA. And you had Kodak that was more skin tone balanced, and Fuji that was more vivid color balanced. And you had all these different emulsions that would give you different responses in the shade or the open sun. And so that really was the first I recall of opening up the palette to creativity with the ability to change films and come up with different looks that way.
And that also, kind of changed, because, during that period also, 35 millimeter was opening up to amateurs, right? That was a way for a professional to distinguish themselves, was to use a professional back with, professional film, as opposed to, your Canon AE-1 with a kit lens and off in and off flash, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. It also opened up the professionals to what later became the wall portrait market, because now they had a capture device in the film that would allow them to go to wall size prints. Mm-hmm. Whereas with the 35, once you got past the 8x10 or 11x14, you were kind of questionable as what you could do with it.
I found it interesting that you were mentioning the album as the final product, because today I just don't get the feeling photographers shoot a wedding with a final product in mind.
I would very much agree with that. Just thinking about your own organizational name here, I think the live pixels don't know an album. the live pixel album is the screen they're looking at it on.
Right. So getting into that, you've been working with photographers. You've been working with, especially the last 10 years, you've been working with photographers who are, ambassadors and also, key customers and whatnot. How have they adapted to the change in not only technology, but also in what the expectations are from the bride and groom, mostly the bride, but let's say the bride and groom.
Well, I think one of the biggest factors, and you mentioned that I've been around for a long time. So there was a period of time where PPFA was doing studies and it became apparent that the industry was moving from a male-dominated industry to a female-oriented industry. Sure. That made a huge difference because, and I don't want to be typecasting or anything like that, but in general, feelings became more involved with photography as opposed to just technology. So the technology today has lightened the weight of the camera. It has increased the ability to do lighting on location, and it has given us a set of tools to use via computers and softwares and apps and everything else to take things beyond the initial capture. So I think all those things together have really changed the type of person that is a photographer. Still visually oriented, but not the mechanic of the old days as much as the technical or emotionally driven today. So I think there's a huge difference that took decades to actually transition from one to the other. But now it's a lot more impulsive now. It's a lot more immediate. And it's a lot more, I almost want to say user-friendly, but you know, back in the day, you did a wedding and they were looking at getting a final album 6 to 8 weeks down the road. Today, if you don't see an image before you leave the wedding party, something's wrong.
<You know? laughs> Wow. That's something. So I remember when PPFA recognized that trend because they changed the name of their magazine from Professional Photographer Magazine to Storytellers. Mm-hmm. And then they kind of went back. They went back to Professional Photographer. So I thought that was kind of interesting. But that is an interesting insight into sort of not only is the technology changed, but also the ability of the photographer to tell that story.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So from the output side of the business, that's a very, very different value proposition because there isn't always an album. Although there always seems to be a belief that the bride and the groom want an album, and there's a lot of debate whether that's actually the case, whether they want a physical album or whatnot. Of course, there's a lot of societal changes too in terms of how people are, where they're having weddings, and you know, there's destination weddings now. There's, you know, very fewer of them are occurring in churches. So it's just, there's a lot of change in that wedding market right now.
Yes, it's huge, and it's a spectrum, and there's extremes on both ends. You still have traditional photographers that are producing albums, wall prints, folios, and things of that nature, because there's still customers from my generation and the next generation that value those things. But there's also on the other spectrum, the other end of the spectrum, photographers that are passing along live pixels, to put it in your vernacular. Yeah. I mean, they're sharing on screens. They're offering downloads. They're letting the customer make the decision as to whether it goes into a slideshow on an iPhone or some kind of an app that's being posted on a website or shared on Instagram. So I mean, it's very different than it was before. But on the plus side, I think in general, a lot more eyes might be seeing the images, because in the old days, there was an album and maybe some prints for mom and dad and grandma and grandpa, and a very limited number of people saw the wedding photography unless you went to the bride and groom's house to look at their album. Whereas today, it can be hundreds or thousands of people that are viewing images online or being passed via text messages or who knows what. So. Right. I think there's a give and take in the whole process.
You know, it's kind of interesting because you've kind of touched on a point that is kind of interesting how the wedding is now becoming almost a promotional tool for the photographer, in a sense, through, like you said, posts during the wedding with the hashtag to Instagram and things like that. So really, photographers have to become much more savvy in terms of marketing than I think they would maybe be 30 years ago. I think not to say they weren't savvy, because that's not what I'm saying, but I think it was a very, very different sort of marketing.
Yes, and I do think that they have to be much more savvy as far as technology is concerned, because it just keeps changing all the time. Probably a big difference, Gary, was, and I'm not saying this for all photographers, but in general, back in the day, photographers did weddings, and they realized, I used to do programs training photographers on the fact that a wedding could be the opening the door to a customer for the rest of your life, because the weddings lead to children, lead to families, lead to school pictures, lead to high school seniors, lead to the next generation of weddings. So you have this cycle that goes over and over and on and on.
Right.
I don't think today's photographers in general, I don't think they think that way. I think a wedding photographer is a wedding photographer. A wedding photographer is kind of a catch and release program where they do the images, and in many cases offer them as downloads, so they never see the customer again, and they're perfectly happy, you know, they're perfectly happy to provide images, and they don't even know what the final output might be, and they don't even know how many people are utilizing those images, and they don't care.
It is sort of that photography as a service model, right, where you're going to have somebody come and photograph your wedding or your wedding, your reunion or something like that. And you're just going to hand over the images and they're off.
In that sense, it's become more similar to what commercial photography used to be, because that used to be the big difference between commercial photography and portrait photography is you'd pay a commercial photography lots of money to show up and take the images, and he'd hand you a piece of transparency film or a final output. And the photographers were, you know, $29 sitting fees. And they made it. They made their money and their profit selling the output and the prints. Well, that model has changed.
Mm-hmm. It's really kind of gone. It's kind of gone back to the roots, actually, because I think early photography was like they paid for the sitting fee, and that was the higher value than the actual output. Because, and you know, back in the day, you were just using glass plates and whatnot. Mm-hmm. Now that's even before our time, the glass plate.
Yes, it is.
So what do you think is the constant that's been constant through all these decades of the portrait industry? What has been consistent that, you know, photographers can rely on?
My experience and my training, I always go immediately to the fact that we are in the people business. We create a product, but we're in the people business. So customer service is a constant. Relationship building is a constant. You may only be, the photographers today might only be seeing the customer or the client for that one day or for that one job, but you never know. And it's still a relationship. Once we get together and there's the only thing between you and the subject is a camera, you build a relationship. So it's the relationship business, it's service and it's people. The other thing I think that are constant is quality. There's no substitute for quality. Now, quality is kind of subjective when you look at it from, you know, just the standpoint of what's good and what's bad, because your taste might be different than my taste. But quality as far as a lasting product, quality as far as a finish that lets the person know that they got what they paid for kind of thing. Mm. And I think another constant is visual excitement. Photography in general is visually exciting to all of us. Now, we all may have different types of photography that we like, but it captures our attention and captures our imagination. So I think it's an exciting business to be in. It's a people business. Technology is changing that. We can do it from more distances. We can do it in different places, but there's still this connection. Even if that connection is just on Instagram for a moment, or, you know, through social media for a back and forth exchange. There's still this connection that makes it a person-to-person activity.
So you've also been on, you know, the lab side. You know, there's been a lot of changes there too. Like you said, there's been, I remember when labs would actually, you know, construct the albums for the photographers and all that. And that's to some extent gone to photo books and things like that. And, you know, I think there's still some album out there, but it's, you know, very, very small part of the market compared to what it used to be. How are the labs coping with this new kind of photographer?
Well, I think the labs today the labs that are surviving and doing well today have become the model of adaptation. I mean, again, back in the day, we produced photo prints and that was about it. Mm-hmm. Variations of photo prints. Nowadays, a lab it manufactures photos on a variety of substrates, from paper to metal to wood. But they do still build albums. They do still build books. They do framing. They still do coffee cups and key rings and things like that. Mm-hmm. Labs today are also divergent in the sense that they recognize there's a difference between the professional market and the retail market, and they can custom tailor their products to fit different markets. Labs today may be fulfilling through websites. They may be fulfilling through multiple storefronts. They may be fulfilling for individual photographers through partner relationships with online services. A photographer can easily put up a website in a gallery, connect it to a lab, and be selling images that are delivered across the country or around the world. So they become much more involved in shipping, much more involved in coming up with new products, new ways to use the image. And because it's digital, I mean, we used to print prints and slip them into an album page. Now with digital, prints are printed on pages, they're printed on wood, metal, or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's a different process entirely. And you still have the traditional photo processes of light sensitive emulsion, but you've got this whole genre of inkjet type or dye sub type printing that allows for the creation of a whole new world of products.
I think you've hit on something that really has been a strong effect in the industry, because for decades, the driver in terms of technology was the Eastman Kodak company. You know, they came up with a technology platform. They would, in terms of, you know, film and the emulsion and chemistry, and they even sold the equipment to analyze the, you know, the PVACs back in the day and everything else to analyze the prints and all that technology. And that's really missing today. That sort of leadership isn't really there, where you would have major vendor, and, you know, Fujifilm to some extent too, who were providing really the infrastructure for the lab. And nowadays, a lab has to be far more creative, I think, be far more aggressive in terms of their own product development than they ever had to be.
Right. I think that's particularly true on the professional side. If you look at the way the industry and just everything is evolving, that line between professional and retail, amateur and enthusiast, is really blurry. Mm-hmm. And you'll see, you don't have a Kodak leading a professional charge. When you see companies like Nikon pulling out of professional trade shows, and you see companies like Panasonic and Sony going into professional trade shows, you know that there's huge changes out there. One other point I wanted to bring up, this may be a little bit off your question, but one of the points I wanted to bring up before we lose the conversation is, and you would remember this well, back in 2007, 2008, PMA and DEMA were featuring The Long Tail, a book by Chris Anderson.
Yep.
Do you remember that?
Oh yeah, definitely.
And I think we're seeing the long-term effects of the long-term phenomena. There used to be a finite number of professional photographers in the U.S. And we used to work with a number that said something like, you know, 30,000 was the top number of full-time professionals and maybe 100,000 part-timers. Nowadays, you're looking at numbers that no one can count because they're in the millions, because everybody with an iPhone, everybody with an Android with a good camera is potentially a professional photographer through websites and through sharing sites and through social media. So it's very different. But the reason I bring up the long tail is because now you've got millions of people doing specialty items. You'll see the genre of landscape and nature is exploded. Before it was just kind of a separate little category that was just within something else. I mean, it didn't produce that much and it was a real niche. But now you've got these little areas, what would have been little areas that are now areas of concentration that people can make their statement with.
But is that a business, I wonder?
That's a real good question. I talk to photographers all the time. I mean, it used to be full-time, part-time, or amateur. Now it's, you know, you can divide that up probably another 20 times. Yeah. I'm still involved in a couple of weekly meetings with photographers. We do Zoom calls. We do things like that. And there's everything from retirees who've never touched a camera before to full-time studio owners on these calls. And there's everything in between. And, you know, there's somebody that has an exhibit at the local restaurant. There's somebody that has an exhibit at a recreation hall in town. They all consider themselves professionals as soon as they sell one image. And that image may be a download through Smug Mug, or it could be a print that they sold through Shoot Proof, or who knows.
Right.
But as soon as they do that, in their minds, they're a professional. And there's still those people that believe they're a professional, even if they haven't sold one, because they want to.
Right.
So that's a tough thing to put a actual definition on.
Yeah, because you would think being a professional means you're at least making some money at it. I mean, that would be part of the definition of professional, right?
Traditionally, yes. But nowadays, I think a lot of people think they're a professional if they're spending money on it. You know, if they're taking classes, if they're reading books, if they're buying cameras. So, I mean, you and I would probably define professional differently,
right.
But it really is up to each individual to say, what are you? And even some people that are selling prints, they don't call themselves professionals. They just happen to sell a print. So the definition's all over the board.
You mentioned something earlier that I found interesting was the remark about trade shows. That's mm-hmm. really changed. And it was changing even before COVID, because I started to see it where, you know, like at some of the big photographer shows, I was going to WPPI. I haven't been to imaging in a while, but I'd been to WPPI probably three or four years ago. You got a sense from the big supporters like the labs that it was not as cost effective as it could have been in terms of exhibition space. And then, like you said, you mentioned you got Nikon pulling out of shows, which is unheard of probably, you know, like Photo Plus and things like that. What do you think the future is of those end user type shows?
I think, and I hope that shows come back because there's still a real need for people to people contact.
Sure.
Absolutely. My guess would be that they won't be as big, as involved as they were before. You are exactly correct that at least on the professional side, trade shows were diminishing. I think that's true all the way up to Photokina. They were getting smaller. I can speak more intelligently to the trade shows in the US, but when you look at the anchor stores, like in a mall, I call the camera companies and the labs are kind of the anchor stores. Sure. And you look at the key anchor stores in a photo trade show. And in the last year before COVID, in 2019, look at those companies that ceased participating. And it's amazing.
Yeah.
There were things such as a major lab that didn't go to WPPI, but they went across the street and put on their own workshop seminar.
Right.
There were, you know, there's things like that where I believe the major companies started to realize that when you put yourself in with everybody else, you're diluting by jumping in the ocean with a bunch of others. Yeah. Whereas if you can create your own pond and be the big fish in that pond, you'll get more attention. And that's kind of an effect of the long tail in a way,
right.
Because you're creating a big fish, little pond mentality, and you've got some more control. And in the last few years, trade shows have been all about capturing email addresses and creating lists. And you do that so you can go back and then start communicating and building up. And it's a numbers game that is way beyond what used to be the handing out business cards and shaking hands. And you come back with, you know, 100 or 150 possible leads. And now it's how many people went to the show? There's 10,000. I expect to come back with 9,000 names and email addresses, and what can I do to get that? And then we're going to communicate them with them, maybe even before we leave the trade show floor, definitely within a week, mm-hmm. you know, that kind of thing. It's right. very different.
Yeah, you know, I mean, coming from, you know, my background with PMA, which, you know, the annual PMA show was, you know, our largest revenue driver. And it was clear even then, you know, when I left PMA in 2012, even going towards that time, that the trade shows were struggling. Like, this has been coming on for decades, actually. You know, in
right.
the print industry, we're seeing the, you know, consolidation among the print shows. It's just like you said, a shame, because it does bring people together. And that's the part that I would like to see continue in some way, shape, or form, because you need the investment of some exhibitors somewhere to drive traffic, to drive interest, you know, because people do want to get their hands on the latest Canon or the latest Nikon or the latest Sony. They do want to see what output looks like, you know, they do want to see what a giant print looks like. Uh-huh. And so there's a value in that. But in the end, I mean, you're kind of asking a lot of the vendors to invest in, just to get people together so they can have a cocktail party. And I don't know what the business model is for that in the future, but you're right. I would like to see them continue.
Well, and I think the trend that I saw even before COVID, and I think what will likely happen after we get back to some kind of normal situation, is vendors will start putting more emphasis on the education side of a convention rather than the trade show.
Right. Yeah, I agree.
Photographers go to trade shows for multiple reasons. There's awards presentations, there's education, there's camaraderie and social, and there's a trade show. The trade show, after a while, becomes less attractive because they can get the same information online, they can get it faster. They do still want to see the big prints, they do still want to see the new camera lenses and those kinds of things. But my guess will be the sponsorship will shift to the photographers, to the education, to the classrooms. Mm-hmm. I already saw that starting much more mm-hmm. In 2018, 2019. And I believe that's what's happening when you see vendors go offsite to do their own thing. They're getting more involved in the education. They're getting more involved in the hook that will keep the customer attached to them. That'd be my guess of where we're going.
So it's kind of hollowing out the event, or kind of inverting the event, if you will. Now, what I think is going to affect the economics of that, unfortunately, is, you know, the exhibits kind of underwrite the education side of it. So that keeps the education side affordable. And will people, maybe if there is no trade show, let's say, for example, you and I create an event, Gary and Glenn's Photo Expo or Photo Conference, and it's basically, you know, 2 days of education, some tabletops and things like that, but you and I are going to have to charge $300 a head for people to attend that, because we've got still got rooms to occupy and overhead to cover and things like that. Whereas back in the day, you could kind of cover that with trade show expenses, right? You overcharge the exhibitor so you can pay for that stuff. What do you think do you think photographers are willing to pay for education at that, under that model?
I do. But don't shortchange the fact that I think vendors will shift to putting more money on the education side, and they'll be in the room. So eventually those will be like mini trade shows in a way, because in an education room, when you're there as an exhibitor, you're shaking hands and you're not trying to necessarily sell them things. You're trying to be part of the team, part of the group.
Right.
So I think there's a difference that way. So I think that vendors will still be involved. Now, I noticed in the last few years, sponsorship monies was increasing, and organizations were asking vendors more to cover things like hotel rooms for the speakers and meals, things that they didn't ask for specific coverage of before, because it was in the sponsorship package. It was in the trade show package. Right. I see some of those things being separated out, and vendors involved in those things. So the revenue won't, it'll go down. But at the same time, Gary, keep in mind, a major vendor going to a trade show spends hundreds of thousands of dollars in physically going to the trade show, in shipping and setup and teardown and booths. If they don't have to spend that anymore, and they spend a little bit more on the education side, they're still saving money. Yeah. And if they're getting more better effect because the speakers are talking about what they offer, it actually could be a win-win for everybody.
Yeah, and I think you're exactly right on that, because I think that was one of the things people in the industry who attended shows like PMA or Photokina really did not know how much those booths actually cost in terms of just the overhead. I mean, construction. I mean, for example, if you go to CES, they're building those booths for weeks ahead of time.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
they're paying union wages for that. I mean, it's a very expensive event. Go ahead,
Gary. If I could offer one more aspect of this,
absolutely,
and that is, when I say education used to be a bunch of people sitting in a room taking notes. The new education is the workshop format. The new education is people with cameras creating images, leaving an event with a portfolio, leaving an event with samples. If you look at shows such as Shutterfest, Portrait Masters, ClickCon. There was one in 2020 at the beginning of the year on dance photography in Phoenix area. They become more specialized. They're smaller from the standpoint of 300, 500, maybe 1,000 attendees, but they're charging more money. They may not be charging more for the ticket to get in, by the time you take the classes, do the workshops, involve yourself, you're going to a hotel. So the model's already there for photographers to spend more money. And I think photographers are willing to do that if they're getting something, if they're coming back with images they can use. That's huge in their mind. So I think there is a shift that's already happening.
And hopefully, as we move forward into 2021, things will start opening up and we'll see those events.
Exactly.
So as we draw to a close, what is your feeling about the professional photography industry? You know, you've seen a lot of change. You're still engaged. You're still excited. What do you see as the near-term future?
I still think it's a viable option. I think that if I was entering the industry, I would be much more aware of technology. I think good light is always going to be good light. but the technology of two things. I think technology of the cameras and the software and the computers involved and all those things is huge. I think the other thing is, in the old days, we used to buy a Hasselblad camera and we'd shoot with that camera for 25 years. I still have the Hasselblad I got in 1971. In today's market, you're turning over equipment every 2 to 3 years. You're staying on top of new lenses. You're staying on top of new technology and new apps. I mean, you are staying on top of those things if you want to stay viable. So it's a different mindset entirely. I think adaptation is one of the key words. So a photographer that's flexible, a photographer that's looking for constant, is willing and able and enjoys constant change and challenge, will do really well in photography. But again, I also go back to the thing that I don't think should change is you're in the people business, even if those people contacts are less in terms of amount of time, they're still valid and viable, and it still puts you at an advantage over big box stores and things like that.
Well, great. Well, great, Glen. Thank you for taking time to talk today, and hope to talk to you or see you sometime in 2021.
Gary, it's always a pleasure, and thanks for having me.
Thank you for listening to the Dead Pixel Society podcast. Read more great stories and sign up for the newsletter at www.thedeadpixelssociety.com.